Hi, welcome to Bird Podcast. I'm Shobha Narayan. This episode is about the peacock. Not because it's the national bird of India, which it is, but because it gave rise to the second most important work in evolutionary biology. I speak, of course, of Charles Darwin's theory of sexual selection. Darwin has referred to the peacock just three times in his magnum opus, The Origin of Species. But the bird gave him so much grief. In 1860, a year after he published The Origin of Species, Darwin wrote to his friend, the botanist Asa Gray, and I quote, "The sight of the feather in a peacock's tail, whenever I gaze at it, makes me sick," end quote. It took Darwin's 11 years to come up with a theory of sexual selection to explain the beauty of a peacock's tail and other seemingly useless male ornaments, as he called it. Darwin's theory was that the male peacock's spectacular feathers and fan-like tail evolved to attract peahens, to attract suitable mates. The more attractive the peacock is, the more its chances of mating and therefore passing on the genes to the next generation. Ergo, sexual selection. Lots of scientists built upon Darwin's theory of sexual selection, most importantly, Ronald Fisher, an English statistician. He created the runaway theory, which basically says that sexual selection accelerates the preference of a specific trait or ornament, like a peacock's tail, causing this preferred trait and the female preference for it to increase together in a positive feedback cycle. So the peacock's tail emerges, the female likes it, it becomes bigger, the female likes it, it becomes bigger, and so on. Richard Dawkins wrote about it in his book, The Blind Watchmaker. There were also some studies that show the opposite. For example, Japanese researchers, over the course of 7 years, observed 268 matings in a feral population of Indian peafowl, that is peacocks and peahens, and showed that the peahens didn't really care about the beauty of a peacock's tail, which sort of makes sense because all peacock's tails look broadly the same. So then why would a peahen choose one over the other? But the point is that the peacocks need to do more and often do more than just spread their tails to win a mate. You see, the peacock, like all lekking species, a lek is like an Indian swayamwara or a Hindu swayamwara. Males of the species gather in a group. They strut and preen around. They compete with each other for the same woman or peahen. Like other lekking animals, like the hummingbird, the Mediterranean fruit fly, the sage grouse, peacocks have evolved to display their ornaments before the females in a group. And these peahens, my God, they are so choosy. It has been shown that in an average peacock lek, only 5% of the males get the majority of the peahens. The rest of them get zero. So the peacocks have to do all kinds of things to get the girl, as it were. One study shows that they make these infrasonic cooing sounds that are not audible to human ears. Another study shows that these peacocks were practicing whispering sweet nothings, as it were, in front of a concrete bunker, which is sort of like practicing before a mirror before you go and sort of drop a line to the girl in question. Peacocks fate mating hoots to make the peahen believe that they got the girl, as it were, when they actually haven't. All this for what? Why does the peacock do this when there's only a 5% chance that they will succeed? The peacock does it for passion, because out of, a genetic destiny, they do it based on the assumption that the peahen or somebody is watching. So to use the phrase as proud as a peacock is wrong, because peacocks are desperate species. They sort of debase themselves in the name of love. They do all these things. They open the tail, they dance, they sing, they coo, they fly, just to get a single proud peahen to notice and choose them. So it's like Tom Stoppard said, that the single assumption that makes our existence viable and worthwhile is the assumption that somebody is watching us. So that's why the peacock does it. Perhaps more than any other bird, The peacock provides fodder for legend, story, and mythology. For example, in Hindu mythology, the peacock is the vahana or vehicle of an ancient and tribal god called Muruga or Kartikeya. He rides on a peacock which kills a snake, which itself is a symbol of the circle of time. So the peacock in that sense provides enlightenment by killing these circles of time or Maya that humans are caught in. When you admire Indian silk saris, for example, from Kanchipuram, you will notice a woven motif that comes again and again. The local word for this motif is called Annapakshi. And when I saw it, I thought it was a peacock. It appears in all the borders of silk saris. In fact, this Annapakshi motif and its history goes back to the arrivals of the Aryans or the Indo Iranians who came to India from Persia. In Persian mythology, there is a bird called Simurgh. The Simurgh has the same etymological cognate, which is to say that it's derived from the same root as the Sanskrit word Siena, which refers to a raptor, an eagle, or a bird of prey. Now, here's the neat thing. If you look at the Simurgh in tapestries or paintings or brass reliefs from Iran, the design looks remarkably similar to the Annapakshi in Kanchipuram saris. It has the head of a dog or a dragon and the tail of a peacock. Imagine that. This mythical beast that traveled from Iran all the way through the Hindu Kush mountains into North India and onwards down to Tamil Nadu, where the weavers of Kanchipuram adopted it and incorporated it into the motifs that adorn the silk saris that Indian women wear to this day. That is the power of this metaphor, this motif, the peacock, dog, mythological beast called Simurgh. The peacock is also the stuff of verse. In the 7th century, there is a Sanskrit poem called Mayurashtakam, which is very erotic. It talks about a young girl coming out of a secret chamber. Her face is blooming with perspiration. The flowers in her hair have fallen and her girdle has come loose. She longs for the breeze. So this, in 8 verses, this Mayurashtakam talks about eroticism. The word for peacock is Mayura in Sanskrit. And in fact, India's biggest dynasty, the Mauryas, that word comes and it means of the peacock. In Iran, there was a dynasty that sat on the peacock throne. So in this way, the peacock metaphor prevails all through South Asia. The peacock belongs to the family Phasinidae or pheasants, and it's generally accepted that all pheasants come from South Asia or India. There are 3 species, the green peacock or the green peafowl to be accurate, which is native from Indonesia to Myanmar. The Congo peafowl, which lives only in Africa in the Congo and was relatively unknown until 1936. The Indian peacock or the blue peafowl, which is native to South Asia and now has spread throughout the world because of human interest in the species. The earliest record we have of the peacocks moving west is in the Bible, where King Solomon imports the bird along with gold, silver, ivory and apes. And this was in about 1000 BC. Most peafowl art, mythology and study relates to the Indian peacock because it's much hardier, more widespread and more sociable than the Congo peacock. And most of the mythology around peacocks ignores the peahen and focuses on the male and its feathers quite naturally. The peacock has color variants. Some of one mutation is of an entirely white peacock, which is like a peacock wearing a wedding dress. The Indian peacock strain consists of about 140 feathers. Around 100 of these have the ocelli or the eyes. The remainder are just longer and green and they end in a V shape. This strain is not an encumbrance for the peacock, which can fly. In fact, over a short distance, the peacock can run faster than a human. But it can be a liability when the peacock is roosting. Its natural habitat, the peacock actually, in the forest, the peacock's main predator is the tiger. So if the peacock doesn't make sure to roost high in the sky so that its strain is well out of the way, A tiger can catch hold of its, these feathers with its claws and pull the peacock down. For this reason, if you observe, peacocks naturally fly to the tallest trees in Rajasthan. The peacock doesn't have this long train throughout the year. It actually appears only in mating season, which starts in February in India. And then the mating season is in August. And after August, the peacock's train molts or it goes away. But during the mating season, the bird will fan out its train and circle around slowly so that he can be admired from all angles. And then he does this little dance where he ruffles the feathers a little bit as he does so. And the movement actually emanates from the tail. In Indian dance, specifically in Odissi and Bharatanatyam, the dancers have imitated the movements of this peacock, its mating ritual, with much stylization. Now, what does the peahen do in response to this? Mostly it ignores the peacock. It sort of acts nonchalant and eats the seeds on the ground, ignoring the smell of the species entirely. The peacock, which, by the way, has a pretty ugly foot, if you look at its feet, in contrast with the beauty of its tail, the feet are quite ugly. And they have these what are called metatarsal spurs or thorns on the feet that are used for the peacock when they fight one another. But really, no one pays attention to the leg because everybody's focus is on the peacock's tail. Recently, Amos Zahavi, who is the Israeli evolutionary biologist, has proposed a handicap theory. He has suggested that features such as the peacock's tail act as honest signals of the male's fitness because the less fit males are disadvantaged by the difficulty of surviving with such large, conspicuous and ornamental structures such as their tails. The peacock in the forest, is an omnivore. It eats plants, flower petals, seeds, also reptiles and amphibians. Wild peafowl look for the fruit by scratching on the ground, which is a common sight in Indian forests. They go retreat into the shade during the hottest part of the day. They're not picky eaters. They hunt for insects and ants, crickets, termites, millipedes, and even small mammals. As I said, in the mythology, the peafowl is shown to be eating a peacock is shown to be eating a snake, and they actually do eat small snakes. The peacock is polygamous. They are terrestrial feeders. They nest on the ground, but they roost in the trees. They also relish human feed like oats, corn, cooked rice, cheese even, because in Rajasthan, you will see peacocks roaming around homes and offices, and the people feed them a variety of things. So the peacock, except for its long tail, which is, yes, it's an object of beauty. Yes, it's hugely ornamental. And the reason why a nation like India has chosen the peacock as its national bird, from an evolutionary standpoint, it could be viewed as a disadvantage. In her book about the peacock, Christine Jackson suggests that attitudes towards this bird divide the East from the West, with Eastern associations being largely positive. For example, in Hinduism, Lord Krishna is associated with the peacock, wearing peacock feathers in his head. The Western associations are largely negative because, for example, in the West, pride is the primary quality that is associated with the peacock. And also the idea that the peacock's feathers are bad luck is a strongly European one. And it is probably a superstition, but it's unclear how it came about. Perhaps because of the resemblance between the feathers, ocelli, and the evil eye. So the divide breaks down slightly on closer inspection. For example, in Java and Myanmar, there is a belief that the peacocks will peck out the eyes of small children, mistaking them for the precious stones that these birds like to swallow. In the Christian tradition, the peacock is used to represent pride, yes, as in the depictions of the seven deadly sins. But conversely, it's also used to depict as a symbol of incorruptibility of Christ, because the bird's flesh, when dried, does not rot. I want to end with the peacock's connection to mathematics, which I learnt about in George Joseph's book, Crest of the Peacock, The Non-European Roots of Mathematics. And he has this wonderful verse in it. It says, "Like the crest of the peacock, like the gem on the head of a snake, so too is mathematics at the head of all knowledge." And it comes from the Vedanga Jyotisha, written in 5000 BC. So the next time you see a peacock strutting around and spreading its tail, do not think it proud. Realize that the male peacock will do almost anything for the sake of love, even though its chances of achieving a mate are slim at best. Angela Duckworth has a word for this behavior. She calls it grit. Bird Podcast is produced by Ullas Anand and EcoEdu. If you would like to volunteer with us, we need you to help us research, script, and produce episodes. Please visit birdpodcast.com for details. For now, this is me, Shobha Narayan, signing off. Thanks for listening.